I wanted to be in a film, just like a lot of other people. You know, you like the idea of the film thing. It's like, it can be a good experience. I remembered Hard Day's Night and Help, and some of the laughs we had, and some of, you know, looking around for titles for days, you know. And it's great when you're with a big crowd of people who are sort of talented and, you know, creative team. It's quite a good way to live, I think. So I remembered that, and I wanted to do the similar kind of thing. So I approached a lot of people about various projects, various ways to get me working on a film.
What sort of scripts were you being offered when you got them?
I tend to get offered the kind of the pop star scripts, you know, like I'm sure Bob and a lot of people will get these kind of scripts, which is like troubadours. You often got a lute or something, and oh my family, you know, Will Scarlet and what is it, Robin, who is it? The fellow went round singing all the time.
Is it Will Scarlet? Yeah,
Will Scarlet, I think it was. Yeah. Or Alan and Dale. Alan and Dale? It could have been Al. Anyway, one of
those are
lads,
the sort of parts.
That's the kind of part you get. Yes.
Not the Richard Gere
part.
Not the Richard Gere part.
No, they saved them for him.
So then what happened when you actually wrote your own script? How did you write it? I mean, did you know about how to do it? You know, tracking shots and panning?
Not really. I didn't know the technical stuff. But I've been talking to people, and a couple of people had said that some of the greatest writers for film, sometimes they can write bad films because they're really good writers. They're great with words. They're not necessarily good with images. So something like Indiana Jones, which is just images, just full of, there isn't a plot, really. There's not much of a plot. So that was the thing, really, was to, in talking about other people, writing stuff, you'd get really great dialogue or great stuff from somebody like Stoppard or those boys. I mean, it'd be no problems on the dialogue at all.
No one.
But he might not have the kind of pictures and the images you want to make. You know, he's a very kind of cerebral type of writer. And sometimes you want to see Indiana Jones leaping around hitting people or whatever. So there was that kind of conflict. And in the end, I just thought, well, what with videos and all of that, and stuff like that that was coming in over the last few years, you know, into the music scene. You're always looking for ideas, you're talking storyboards with people. So I suppose that gave me a bit of confidence. I thought, well, I've talked to a lot of people about film, because you tend to now in the music business, it tends to cross over with the video thing. So I thought, I'll just give it a go.
Did you just write it on a notepad?
And I was in a car in a traffic jam, and I just had some paper. And I just got my pencil out and just started like writing it, and it was literally, the film opens with, you know, I couldn't think of any other, didn't really think I needed a clever opening. It was an image to give to the director with a shot.
All the lonely people, where do they all come from? All the lonely people, where do they all belong?
My friends did Eleanor Rigby in the film, and I just really, in the script I wrote, while the song happens, the images are churches, altars, back streets, Dickensian, choir boys, whatever came into my mind. I don't know how the choir boys got in there.
What was it like once you'd actually finished it? Who did you show it to? Did you show it to the family first, or what was it like?
Not first, because when it's first finished, it's in a bit of a rough stage, and the kids wanted to see it when it was finished. You know, I don't like showing it to people, anyone actually, until it's really finished. But I showed it to people like David Putnam and stuff, and he liked it. You know, he was pleased that we'd made a film, a British film. As he put it, you know, there are a lot of people out there who can talk a great film, but not many of them actually go through the whole process and get it finished, get it done, and get it released, you know.
One of them. Probably the only one, is that it's a bit like a sort of family home movie. because there's Linda and there's Ringo and there's Ringo's wife and things.
Mm.
Do you think that's justified?
Well, you know, the thing about critics is obviously, like, everybody's got one, and that's like an opinion. You've got one too.
Mine's a small one.
Not easy to find. Nope. Come on, lads. The thing about the critics is they've all got an opinion, obviously, like, and nearly everybody's opinion is different. You know, if you ask 100 people what they think of something, someone say, "Oh, I really like the beat." You know, "Well, I didn't like the beat too much, but I like the melody." "Oh, and I like the drumming. I love the drumming." "Oh, well, I like the bass playing. I like that bit in the middle." You know, everybody does have different opinions. So that's the difficult thing with the critics. You know, when they say something that one or two have said, "Yes, it's like a home movie," it isn't really. But Ringo's in it, and Barbara's in it, and Linda's in it. Then that there, the whole thing ends. Nobody else is any kind of relative at all. Honest. I tried to get you in, Auntie Gin, but they wouldn't go for it. But you know, so that it's not really that much of a home movie. Some other people have said it's just a string of videos. But I think when you look at that criticism, I think what you've got to remember is that film critics are frightened of videos. And I think that's like an interesting... Well, they're frightened. They're in... Their jobs are about to go because the video revolution, you know, is taking over a lot of their territory. And I think they're frightened. So I think if they see anything resembles a video, "Oh, it's just videos. No, you can't make real films."
Defensive though. How do you feel when you read it? Does it still affect you, or do you still, or do you just feel?
No, I wish I felt. What does it matter? You know, and I think a lot of people, when you get some success, I know when I first met Linda, she expected me not to be affected by that. She didn't think I even saw those. You read that stuff? No, she didn't know. You do. You read it. You see it. I mean, even if you try and avoid it, you'll see it in some dentist's chair. I mean, office. In the waiting room, you know, it's always there. There's always some pleasure. So what I do is just look at it, and if there's something that I really hate, you know, it's when they get near to the mark is when you hate it. That's the truth. That's when everyone hates anything. When you get near that truth that you yourself aren't too keen about, you know, "Well, we were just a little slack there, you know, I know we were." And if anyone notices it, that's the worst moment, because it really gets to something that you believe.
He told me he was straight, and I believed him.
I suggested at the time it wasn't exactly the smartest move on earth.
What's he going to do with the tapes?
Bootleg them. There are plenty of people around here who'd pay a big quid to get their hands on those tracks. Big Bob, for instance, to name but a few.
I'm trying to make a perfect film, but if it isn't perfect, I don't want to pretend it's perfect. I'm quite interested what the people say, you know. What is it, you know, who's acting lousy? Someone will no doubt tell me and stuff, but I'd rather know than kind of just fake to myself that I was great, but actually the truth is no one's telling me I was lousy. I'd rather stand up and slug it out with them.
What was it like having to redo the old songs that you did do in the film? When
great.
You re-recorded those, was that a bit...
It was... I expected it to be a bit... And I don't know a bit what, because you don't know a bit what. It's a bit...
Yeah, a bit...
I expected it to be weird, so I thought, I don't know what I thought. I thought, well, you know, some people are going to say, "Oh, you know, you mustn't redo the Beatles stuff. It's sort of, it's done, it's definitive."
Sacred.
Sacred's the word, yeah. But I don't believe that. I really don't believe that. I think a song's a song, and I love the Beatles versions, you know, no problem at all.
Yesterday, all my troubles seem so far away. Oh, I believe in yesterday. Suddenly I'm not half the man I used to be.
Very body appropriate.
There's a shadow hanging over me. Oh, yesterday came suddenly. Why? She had to go, I don't know.
own lots of your songs?
No, not really.
Bet you do.
I don't. I've got past getting angry. I think when you look at it, the justice of it, you know, in the beginning, you think you come down from Liverpool, you don't know what songs are. You get in with a publisher and he's good for you and everything, and you get successful. And if you don't happen to know how to get to own your songs and stuff, you can't really blame him for doing whatever deal he does, you know. So that's the way it was done with us. And other people ended up like, I don't own Yesterday and I don't own Here, There and Everywhere, a lot of those songs. I think if you talk to the people in the street, do you know Paul McCartney doesn't own Yesterday? They sort of say, why, you know, why, what happened, you know? And, you know, when you think that I wrote it, recorded it, went and sold it, was the prime salesman for it, obviously I deserve to sort of own it. Since we became famous as kind of little green Liverpool lads coming down knowing nothing, there's been a bigger boom in music and more people being accessible to more people, particularly British people. You know, we're still doing great in the States and stuff. The kids these days have learned by our lessons. You know, they now know to ask for deals, and they now, which is nice. It means, we had to go through a bit of suffering to have that happen, but it's quite nice, really. If we had to go through it, I'm glad that at least it paved the way for a bunch of other people who now, when they go and publish a song, will say, hey, I want a decent deal on this. And they'll know about getting ripped off. We didn't even know there was such a thing as publishers. Literally, John and I thought that songs belonged to everyone. They were just in the air. I think a lot of people think like that. You know, just songs. You can't own a song, can you?
John?
Yeah, a couple of them.
What do you think about all of those books? How do you think they portray you?
Oh, they don't. I know they portray me as the villain, you know. They portray me as the. What's happened with John and me is it's like once we were equal, Lennon and McCartney, while we were working together, it was kind of equal. We were considered pretty equal, really, because we were just producing equal amounts. But when the split of the Beatles happened and when John moved away to New York and the business stuff made us very bitchy with each other, you know, it's kind of. What happened is John then became the sort of tough one, the hard one with this experimental edge. And I became just the soppy one, just writing the odd ballad and stuff, you know. And John, of course, contributed to that by slagging me off and kind of calling me Engelbert Humperdinck and stuff. Thanks a lot. You know, which was at the time, it was like, oh, God, you know, who needs all this? But I didn't really want to come back at him and say, you know, oh, let me tell you about you. Because I knew we'd just have a big media row, and I just wasn't up for that, you know. I'm really glad.
Ray Coleman book.
And that's the same kind of thing, you know.
It's a tendency because he's dead, he's now a genius, and you're alive, and so you're not.
The day John was killed on the radio, I was listening to all, like everyone, listening to all the news bulletins trying to find out. There was an interview with him saying, oh, I don't want to be a martyr, you know, don't worry, I'm not sticking myself up as a martyr. So, of course, you know, you can't help it. It's what's happened, he's sort of become a martyr. I don't think he would have liked that, I don't know. With somebody, see, what it is like somebody like Ray Coleman's got his opinion. You know, he's entitled. I sort of know why he thinks that and why he thinks that I'm just sort of, you know, a songwriter and John was the genius. I know why it is. John was a very forceful personality. Mostly, I mean, if we had arguments within the groups, I mean, I remember, like, George would turn to us again. He said, oh, he's won again. John's won again. Just because he shouted loudest. And it often used to happen, you know, I'm not bloody doing it. All right, man. And, you know, so there's a lot of that going on. So you do tend to get forced into another position. You know, if somebody's, like, very loud and very I mean, I'm not saying he's just loud. He was a wit. He's a funny man, John. He was a great, clever guy. I loved him, you know. But somehow we got this kind of anti-position, you know. I all started. I didn't like Alan Klein, and they wanted to go with him, you know. I figured that was like a really bad thing to do and would lose us everything we gained. Later, that turned out to be true. You know, everyone got rid of Alan Klein and said thank you to me for it. But while I was trying to get rid of him, I had to go through all this craziness, and it seemed like I was pitted against them for my own gain. It was actually for the common good. Well, you know,
most of the books, though, even the ones like the Coleman one, where he is bending over backwards to make him sound as good a person as possible,
yeah,
by virtue of illustrating his incisive wit, show him as incredibly cruel to the people who he apparently loved most, like you Yoko and Cynthia.
It's right. You know, that's the thing is, like, I mean, I don't really like to go on too much about someone who can't defend themselves and stuff, but that's the truth, you know, is that, like, none of us was the genius. None of us was. John and I did most of the writing, but, you know, George wrote Something in the Way She Moves, and that's the one Sinatra does. Do you know what I mean? After all the Lennon McCartney... No, do you know what I mean? That's the one Sinatra is. So even George was, like, writing great stuff. So I think we were all equal, and Ringo, although he didn't really contribute to the writing and stuff, he was a very equal force in it all. So that, I mean, what I'm saying is that John isn't just the wonderful picture that begins to get painted because he sort of gets martyred. He had his downside, that's for sure. Anyone who knew him knew that he could be really mean. But that doesn't mean to say he was a mean person. He could actually be very, very warm as well, you know. So sort of balanced it up. He was a bit of both, and I think I am too. I think what comes over, what they all say about in the books is me, I'm ruthlessly ambitious, you know, really. Ooh, sweep anything out of my way. Oh, really, you know, JR. But it's just not true. I mean, I'm not like that, you know. I mean, and if I am, John was every bit as ruthlessly ambitious as I am. But you can't help your image.
Hey, doing, Hal?
There were some great moments singing that, Paul, but it wasn't the one.
It's the second one out of every three that is the one.
So what are we doing?
The medley.
What medley?
Okay, Paul, I'd like to hear a run-through, if you don't mind.
Okay.
Finally, what
That's
do you think
story,
the best
kids,
thing is?
Honest.
The best thing is that ever happened to you?
The best thing that
yes,
ever
best.
Happened to
What's
me?
What's the most thrilling?
Oh, I don't know, getting born.
I thought it was going to be meeting Linda.
It's okay. Hang on, I'll just... It was just shortly after I got born, I married Linda. I wanted to be in a film. Just like a lot of other people, you know, you like the idea.